I love this church. I love how when we say we're not going to be a box, we're going to tear down the box, we're going to not just think outside the box. We don't have a box, and we also don't have a countdown this morning. Did anybody notice that? So we do things differently. We're never going to do the same thing twice. So we ask that you stand up this morning as our band. You guys ready? All right. No. Yes. No. We're always ready. God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. We're so thankful, this church, and we're so thankful for our brothers and sisters in Christ. Hello in the balcony. Good morning. As we sing these songs together, I always say, don't just let the words sit on the screens, but do something with them. Where are you in your walk? What are you dealing with? The good, the bad. It's all good because God is good all the time. So take those moments in your life that you seem weary or weak. Let God use you to live this song in your own. Give her every breath. Give her all eternity. We love you, Lord. We sit down and we sing your praises. You be the glory.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to Imagine Church. My name is Gregory, and I'm the ministerial intern here at Imagine Church, and we are glad that you're here this morning. Thank you for honoring God with your presence this morning. And here at Imagine Church, we want to bring you biblical truth and to love you the way Christ loved us. And that says a lot. Would you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we come to you now to ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit and touch the hearts of each and every person here, that they would find rest in you. That we try so hard to do on our own, that they would just find their rest in you. That you would work in their hearts through Pastor Bruce and his message this morning, and that they would be closer to you when they walk out those doors this afternoon. It's in Jesus' name that we ask this. We pray, and we all together say, Amen. Thank you. Enjoy this video.
We all work, and we work hard. Long hours, short breaks, and not near enough pay. We give our passion, our expertise, our lives to the very jobs we work every day. We all have hopes and dreams, dreams of accomplishment, investment, and definitely retirement. But let's not lose track of one thing. This Labor Day, remember that it's not our work that defines us, but how we work, why we work, and for whom we work. Whatever you do, work at it with all of your heart, as working for the Lord. Happy Labor Day.
Well, good morning. Grace to you in peace in the name of our Savior, Lord Jesus Christ. It's good to greet each of you and to welcome you to Imagine Church this morning. We want you to know that whoever you are and wherever you are in your faith journey, there's a place for you at Imagine Church. And we're so honored that you're here. Greetings, everybody in the balcony. Teenagers have discovered the balcony. It didn't take them long, did it? We're so glad all of you are here. This is also summer's last hurrah. And you look around, you realize all the people who are not here, who are squeezing in one last trip this summer, we don't blame them for that. But we're so glad that you're here. One of the things that we said back at the beginning of summer, we kind of made a deal together. It's fine to take vacations, but if you're in town, be in church on Sunday. And so you are, and we thank you for that. I looked this up this week. I didn't realize this, but Labor Day began in 1882 with a parade in New York City that was orchestrated and initiated by a machinist and a carpenter. And that's how Labor Day began. And it's a day when we can honor all those who work, we honor industry and the role that it plays in our society, in our economy, and in our lives. And so I hope all of you tomorrow have a day to just have a time of rest and relaxation, and also appreciation to God for what God has given us that makes it possible for us to enjoy the lives that we have received. Can we pray together? Let's bow our heads and have a prayer for Labor Day. Loving God, we thank you that you have bound us together in this life. And we pray that you give us grace to understand how our lives depend on the courage, the industry, and the honesty, and on the courage of those who labor. May we be mindful of their needs, grateful for their faithfulness, and may we always be faithful in our responsibilities to them. We pray all of this in the name of our Savior, Lord Jesus Christ, and for his sake. Well, last Sunday was one of those red-letter days in the life of Imagine Church because we had an opportunity to welcome into our midst a wonderful family and to bring on to our staff a new young man who's going to be our Imagination Minister of Youth. And we're so excited to have Tim and Andrea Gunn with us. And they're going to share a little bit about some of the plans that are upcoming for our youth. And I want to invite them to come and speak now. Tim, come on up. And is Andrea going to come with you, or is it just you this time?
Just me.
This is our new Minister of Imagination Youth. Will you welcome Tim Gunn?
I appreciate being young again, since you announced me as being young. I feel like I'm pretty old when I hang out with these young kids, but we've been excited coming home, and me and my wife have been really busy. She's probably more busy than I am, but just preparing some things, and I think they're going to show you some dates, but some dates we want to emphasize with you guys. If you want to encourage your youth, I'll be out here in the foyer, and I'll hand these out. Next Sunday, we're going to have our first get-together to try to get to know the young people here. We encourage you to invite any friends they have or anybody that wants to go. What a great opportunity to invite that neighbor or that person that we're trying to reach out to, maybe. We've got a young person. We'd love to have them. We're going to meet at the Bowling Bells right there in Lake Wylie at 4:30. And then when we're done playing for about an hour, we're going to ride over to Pelicans and have some snow cone. And then you can pick them up at Pelicans around 6:30. The cost won't be about $15. That'll be about an hour of bowling and however how many snow cones they want to eat. And then we want to also emphasize another date. The next Sunday, we would love to have parents and youth participate. It's going to be a meal. Am I correct? It's going to be a meal right after church, right here at the church. And we just want to sit around and kind of have some fellowship and eat together. But then also we want to hear your ideas on, because this is just as much as you guys as it is me. We're just leading the ship. But we want to know what you guys want to do. We want to know what you guys want for the youth. We want to know, what ambitions you have, what dreams you have, what vision you have. And then we want to share a little bit of our ideas and just kind of see how you guys feel about it. So we're excited. We're in prayer. Be in prayer for us all the time. And we're looking forward to what God can do and the plans he has for us. Thank you so much.
Makes me want to be a teenager again. What about you? I wouldn't want to go through high school or middle school again, but I wouldn't mind being a teenager again. But Tim, you are a young man compared to some of us here, but we're so proud of you for what you're beginning to do, what you're launching with our Imagination Youth, and for the impact you're going to make in the lives of our teenage sons and daughters and young people, and we're so proud of you. We look forward to all that lies ahead. Just a word about what's coming up for Imagine Church. Next Sunday is one of those unique standalone Sundays that we've been really planning for months. It's entitled On That Day, and it's really going to be a time to look back, but also a time to look ahead as we go back and focus on something that happened 15 years ago to the day. And you know what we're talking about, and that is 9/11, which we'll never forget, those of us who are alive, that Tuesday morning. We have three speakers who are going to come and each share briefly because of a unique perspective that they bring to what happened on that fateful day. And then through their words and through video, but also through scripture, and then kind of my summation at the end of the day, I think it really is going to be a very meaningful and heartfelt time of worship to our Lord. So be here next Sunday for On That Day as we look back at 9/11 and then look ahead. Bring a friend with you to come and worship that day. On the 18th of September, we're going to have something that we've really not done before, and that is a time of consecration for our three program staff members, for Jennifer, who is our director of Worship and the Arts, for Tyra, a director of Imagine Kids, and then for Tim as our director of Imagination Youth. And just a time of consecration and commissioning for all three of these. We look forward to that. It'll be a special moment in worship. And then on the 25th of September, we're going to have a time to kind of look ahead. What's in the future for Imagine Church? What do we envision? What do we think is God's plan and vision for our church over the next 5 years, 10 years, and beyond? So make sure to be here for each of the three next Sundays. Very special Sundays in the life of the church. One of the things that is always a meaningful moment in worship is when we're able to celebrate the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. We have that holy privilege today. And you know that Imagine Church practices an open communion, inviting all who are present on the occasion of worship, regardless of age or any past church membership or affiliation, to join with us around the table as we receive this holy meal. Because the invitation is really not given from a minister or from a church. It's given from our Lord Jesus Christ. And we know from the Gospel of John that Jesus said, "The one who comes to me, I will not cast out." And so let's take just a moment, prepare our hearts now for the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. Thank you. came in for worship today, you received from members of our host team a little purple card. And the last line of that card, and I'm going to speak more about the card in our message today, but that last line is one that has always stayed with me, and that is the prayer, "Teach me the mystery of Christ in me." When I first came to recognize that in my life, I was a really young teenager. I was 13, and at a youth retreat at Lake Junaluska, North Carolina, sitting there in a small chapel with other teenagers, for the first time in my life, I really felt God speaking to me. It was at a communion service. But God was speaking to me, convincing me that this was what I was to do with my life. I didn't completely understand why or what that really meant at the time. But really, from that moment until now, I've never really wavered in the feeling that this is what I was supposed to do. And there are others who are certainly much more talented or skilled at it than me. But there was never a doubt that this is what God wanted me to do with my life. And so for that reason, and for many others, communion is always a very sacred and special time in worship for me. And I know it is for many of you as well. It's a time when we realize that mystery of the presence of Christ within us. And there's something about the sacramental moment that reminds us also of the incredible sacrifice that Jesus was willing to make for you and me, that he might have that personal, intimate, close relationship with us, not as servants or slaves, but as brothers and sisters, as offspring of the same Heavenly Father. That's what we celebrate when the church gathers around the table for the Lord's Supper. We're going to share together in the great Thanksgiving. And I want to invite Gregory, if he'll come up and assist me. And we have two lay servants today who are going to assist as well. And that is Betsy Goodwin and Benita Nugent. I'll invite them to come up as well if they'll join us here at the table. And we'll commune this morning by what the church calls intinction. We'll just have two lines that will come down the center aisle here in the chapel. And you'll receive a piece of bread from the common loaf. The posture of receiving is simply open hands, which symbolizes an open heart and open spirit. And then you'll take the bread and dip it in the common chalice and then commune and then make your way back to your seats by the sidelines. Will you join with me in the words of the great Thanksgiving for the order of Holy Communion? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and cup, and make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Father.
Amen.
Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for it is one loaf of which we all partake. Is not the breaking of the bread a means of sharing in the body of Christ? is not the cup over which we give thanks a means of sharing in the blood of Christ? Two stations here at the front, one for each side of the chapel. And those in the balcony already starting to make their way downstairs, I said. We invite you with the praise team communing first to come forward to receive the Lord's Supper.
Christ in me.
you have given yourself to us, Lord.
Now we give ourselves to others.
Help us to bear your holy name.
As a source of life in our world.
Your Holy Spirit has filled our hearts.
Let it move and correct us always. Amen.
Go in peace and serve God and your neighbor in all you do. We are sent in Christ's name. The blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is with you always. Amen.
Picking back up with our series that's called Stuck that we began back in early August. We've had a couple of very special Sundays. Orange Sunday, which was a wonderful celebration of our Imagine Kids ministry. And then last week, our Missions Sunday. And Tyra actually is going to write the column or the devotional for the newsletter this week and share about the experience that we had on Friday of mailing 135 boxes that you all prepared last Sunday to Bacani in Rosario in La Union province in the Philippines, that they'll receive in about 7 or 8 weeks. They'll have them in time for Christmas. What a difference you're going to make in the lives of children, of young people, of men and women and families because of what you did last week. And we had a prayer before all those boxes got on the truck to be shipped. So I'm proud of you for that. But for me, it feels good to be preaching again today, first time in a couple of weeks. And I've asked Dawn Welshens if she will be our lay reader today and present this passage from Philippians and lead us in prayer before the message. Dawn, would you come and lead us? Thank you.
Thank you, Bruce. The reading today is going to be from Philippians chapter 4, verses 10 through 13. Out of reverence for the Lord Jesus Christ, please stand for the reading of his word. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I am not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all this through him who gives me strength. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we come to you today with thanks and a grateful heart for all you give us every day. We pray that you'll give us the strength to get through times when we're stuck and to conquer our fears, illnesses, and difficulties with grace and dignity. Be with Bruce today as he delivers another wonderful message and touches the hearts of us all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Gregory said he could laugh at that because he doesn't have young children. The parents of young children, I didn't see them really laughing during that video. Well, if you're visiting with us today for the first time, at Imagine Church we do series, which means we get up here and talk about things for 3 or 4 weeks at a time. And so I know this is kind of coming in the middle of a series that we're calling Stuck. And I know that might feel a little bit like coming into the middle of a movie. But the good news is you can go to our website, imaginechurchnow.org, or you can go to our Facebook page, where you'll find part one and part two, because the messages in this series really kind of build on each other. So you can go there if you want to, and you can listen to and watch the first two messages in this series. But let me just tell you basically what this series is about. It's called Stuck, and we're answering this question. What do you do when there's nothing you can do? What do you do when there's nothing you can do? What do you do when you find yourself in a set of circumstances or in a season of life and there's really no way forward and there's no way out? You're in a marriage. It's not really what you thought marriage was going to be. It's really not very good. It's not going anywhere. But there's no really way out. I mean, you don't want to abandon your family, but it's not going in the direction that you want it to go in. Counseling doesn't seem to help. And so you just feel stuck. What do you do when there's nothing you can do? You're 15 years old, and you can't leave home until you're 18. It's like the three longest years of your life, and your parents are idiots. And all of your options are bad. They're just going to land you in jail or get you arrested. And so it's like, what do you do when there's nothing you can do? What do you do financially when things aren't going well? And the only way out is a long, hard road, and you're never going to be where you thought you'd be financially. And the only options in front of you are bad options, things that are going to complicate your life. You're stuck. What do you do when there's nothing you can do? Maybe you got a bad report from your doctor. And whatever it is, it's not going to kill you, but it's going to change your lifestyle. And there's no way to make it better. It's just going to slow you down. It's a forever status that you find yourself in. What do you do when there's nothing you can do? Maybe it's academic. Maybe academically this is where this hits you. Because you always planned on going to medical school. And now you realize you're not going to medical school. You always wanted to go to law school, but you're never going to law school. In other words, your future is not what you thought it was going to be. You're disappointed in you. Your parents are disappointed in you. Your friends, they're trying to be nice, but you think they're talking about you behind your back. Your dream is not coming true, and there's no way to fix it. This is just life for you. What do you do when there's nothing you can do? And there's no way forward, and there's no way out? And I really think at the emotional level, where this all lands for us is, we get to the place, somewhere along the way, where we think, I'll never be happy again. You know, my freshman year of college was the happiest time of my life, and now it's just a long downhill slope until death. I'll never be happy again, right? Nothing good can come from this. And I know what at least a few of you are thinking right now. You're thinking, Bruce, don't get up there and tell me that something good can come from this. Because if I were to get up there and tell everybody my sad story, everybody would agree. Nothing good can come from this. You look at your circumstances and you think, there's no happy ending. There's no silver lining. Nothing good can come from this. And then we often come to this. There's no point in continuing. There's no point in staying in this marriage. There's no point in staying in this relationship. There's no point in staying moral. There's no point in staying ethical. There's no point in trying to do the right thing, hoping the right thing's going to happen as a result of my doing that. There's just no point in continuing. And yeah, I know the options I have are really going to make my life more complicated, but I'm just so sick and tired of the status quo. What do I do when it seems like there's nothing I can do? So that's what this series is all about. Now, one of the things that I think is helpful to do when you think about adversity, one of the things that's helpful to think about when you really feel stuck is to remember this. The men and women who brought us the story of the New Testament, actually the entire scripture, but the men and women who brought us the gospel were men and women who were not strangers to adversity. In fact, when you read their stories, you find that conflict was just part of their lives. And here's the interesting thing. Unlike us Westerners, and unlike those of us who honestly, living in America in this day and time, we're a little bit spoiled, we have a conflict sometimes with the idea of there being a good God as long as there's difficulty and conflict in life. But the men and women who brought us the story of Jesus, they were not put off by conflict. They did not see it as a contradiction at all. And their lives were full of turmoil. Their lives were full of difficulty. In fact, a couple of weeks ago, we saw this with the Apostle Paul. Paul, the man who was responsible, basically, for taking the gospel and presenting it across the known world. The man who almost single-handedly planted all the churches around the Mediterranean rim that would eventually create the church that all of us are a part of today. The Apostle Paul had a situation in his life that was painful. Do you remember the list? It was painful, humiliating, debilitating, and permanent. And so he prayed to God, would you remove it? And God said no. But Paul just went right on. Somehow he was able to continue to believe God, trust God, and move on with his life. For him, there was no contradiction. There was no conflict. He was stuck. But he was still able to do amazing, amazing things. What we're going to discover today is this. Not only did he teach us what we learned a couple of weeks ago when he talked about that thorn in the flesh. Today, the Apostle Paul makes this incredibly bold statement. I hope I can do it justice this morning. But the Apostle Paul said that even in the midst of the most incredible adversity, there is a way to find contentment. Contentment. You know what contentment is? Contentment is when something on the inside is at peace, even when everything on the outside is going crazy. Contentment is the ability to stop striving internally, even though everything on the outside is out of control. And the Apostle Paul said, in Christ, there is a way to find and achieve contentment, in spite of the fact that you have no control over what's going on around you. Let me quickly just kind of stop and give you a little background on the Apostle Paul, because this is important, especially if you're new to Bible study. But here's something that you need to understand about the Apostle Paul. As you may know, the Apostle Paul steps onto the pages of history as someone who hates Christians. He was the great Christian arrester. But through an amazing sequence of events, he becomes one. He becomes a Christian. And then he launches into this incredible missionary endeavor where he's planting churches all over the place. Now, about 10 years in, and this is so important, but about 10 years into this endeavor, the Apostle Paul is arrested. And he ends up in Rome, in jail, awaiting trial. And as you may know, the emperor at that time was Nero. So think about this. To be a Christian in Rome, under arrest, with Nero as the emperor, that's not a great combination, is it? Because Nero, who we know, lit his gardens with Christians that he put aflame. Nero blamed the Christians for everything that he could blame Christians for. So here's the Apostle Paul. And by all appearances, it looks like Rome won, Jesus lost. The empire of Rome wins, the kingdom of God loses. It looks like game over. But here's the really cool part, okay? Here's this very ambitious guy, Paul, who has this giant vision to change the world. And yet he finds himself under arrest, in jail, and he has absolutely nothing to do. Because he can't go anywhere, he can't do anything. So he decides, I'm not just going to waste this time. Least thing I can do is write letters. Little did he know that he was writing some of the most widely read, widely translated literature in the history of the world. In his mind, you know what, there's nothing I can do. I'm stuck here. Well, I may as well make the best of it. Guess I'll write a few letters to some of the Christians in some of those cities where I've visited and where I've planted churches. What he ended up doing was writing what we call the prison epistles. We know them today as the book of Ephesians, Colossians, Galatians, Philippians, and Philemon. Now, this is what I want you to get into your head. In his mind, it's, well, whatever, there's nothing I can do. But in reality, he is changing the whole world. He's changing the way people view God. He's changing the way Gentiles could approach God. He's writing literature that would ultimately help overthrow the Roman Empire. In fact, what he wrote was so well read and so well published, it would end up being translated into hundreds of languages. In fact, I think we could argue that after Jesus, the Apostle Paul had more to do with shaping culture than any other person who's ever lived. Because the Bible I have in my hands today contains the writings of the Apostle Paul, some of which were written when he was stuck in prison. I think that's incredible. I guess you all don't think that's quite as incredible as I think it's incredible. But so let me try to tell you how incredible this is. Ladies, do you know while Paul was in prison, he wrote the letter to the Ephesians. And in the letter to the Ephesians, he says this: husbands, love your wives like Christ loved the church, and be willing to give your lives for your wives. Ladies, aren't you glad he wrote that? I mean, that's pretty amazing. And that's just the beginning. So much of this life-changing literature was written during times of extraordinary adversity. Now, here's the point. This is the big deal. Paul had no idea. Paul had no idea. The Apostle Paul had no idea what hung in the balance of his decision to remain faithful when remaining faithful was difficult. The Apostle Paul had no idea what hung in the balance of his decision to continue to follow Jesus when the circumstances mitigated against it. Paul had no idea of what God was up to through him. He has no idea. He just hopes somehow these letters will get through. One more thing, and then we're going to get on with the sermon, I promise. But what are the odds? I mean, come on. What are the odds that letters written in Rome while in prison, what are the odds that they would even survive the first century, much less become part of the most widely read book of all time? What are the odds of that? I mean, emperors wrote things that had been long lost, long gone, and they put them in vaults. They made multiple copies to make sure they were protected. The Apostle Paul is a prisoner. There was one copy, and he said, deliver this, and we're still reading it today. He had no idea what hung in the balance of his decision to remain faithful. You know what hung in the balance? We hung in the balance. The church hung in the balance. And the reason he was able to accomplish what he did, don't miss this because this is important. The reason he was able to accomplish what he did was because of his adversity. And because of his response to his adversity. Now, here's why this is a big deal. You have no idea what hangs in the balance. You have no idea what or who hangs in the balance of your decision to remain faithful when everything around you says, be faithless. You have no idea what God might be up to through your faithfulness. When everything around you says, there's no point being ethical, no point being moral, no point being faithful, there's no point staying. There's no point in telling the truth. There's no point in being obedient. There's no point in saying yes to God because there's no when. You're just stuck. You're living a fantasy out there. You have no idea what hangs in the balance. And the challenge is you'll never know unless you're willing to remain faithful in the face of adversity. It's oftentimes in the face of adversity that God does his most amazing things in us and through us and in the world. And so this really is a big deal. And the worst thing we could possibly do is just hit the eject button to try to get ourselves out of tough circumstances instead of saying, God, I wouldn't have chosen this, but here I am. Here I am. Teach me what it means to be content in the midst of these circumstances. So it's in one of these letters, actually the one he wrote to the church at Philippi, to the Philippians, that he wrote from prison, that the Apostle Paul addresses this issue of contentment. And he makes this big, bold statement that I want to show you and talk about and try to illustrate, and then we're going to get you out of here. So here's what he says. He's writing to the church at Philippi from prison. He says this. He says, I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. So here's what was happening. It's really kind of cool. The Apostle Paul's been arrested. He's in jail. News back then travels slowly. And so finally, the Christians in Philippi get the news that their guy, the guy who started their church, is in prison in Rome. So they send him a care package. It takes a long time for it to arrive. So finally, Paul gets this care package from his friends in Philippi, and he's like, wow, they didn't forget about me. So he writes them this letter. He says, I'm glad that you renewed your concern for me. And he's opening up this care package. And in it, there are some books. And there's a thumb drive with some stuff on it. Maybe some video games. I don't know. Maybe a coat because it gets cold. So he's just very, very grateful. And he uses this as a launching point to talk about this big, complicated word, contentment. Here's what he says. He says, I'm not saying this because I'm in need. In other words, I'm glad you sent me the care package. I'm glad you didn't forget about me, but don't get me wrong. I wasn't afraid. I wasn't going crazy on the inside. I wasn't anxious. For, and here it is, for I have learned. In other words, it took a while. I have learned. It's a process. I have learned. This didn't come intuitively. I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. Now, the idea of content basically means here to be self-sufficient. I've learned to deal with it. I've learned to not let it drag me down. I've learned to live in such a state that even though things around me are really unsure, I'm not stressed out. And I'm not running. Because I've learned to be content. This is an amazing statement. I've learned to be content in whatever circumstances I am in. Now, if I were to stop the sermon right here and say, thank you for being here, let's close in prayer. I don't know about you, but when I read them, I think, maybe it's just me, but I think, I want to learn that. If there's a way to learn how to be content in any kind of circumstances, if there's a way to be okay on the inside, even though things on the outside are not okay, I want to learn that. Where do I sign up for that? I'll be there. Whatever time that class starts, I'll be on the front row if there's a way to learn how to be content in whatever circumstances I'm in. And Paul says, I just want you to know, whether you ever learn it or not, it exists. Whether you ever get there or not, I want you to know there's a category of contentment that works in all circumstances. Now, is it just me, or doesn't that make you kind of want to lean in just a little bit and say, tell me what that is? Because what it means is when you're stuck, when there's no way forward and there's no way out, there's nothing you can do about it, there is a way to be content. That's a powerful thought. Paul goes on. He says, I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. And I love this. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. And when we hear that, we're all kind of leaning in because we want to know the secret of being content in any and every circumstance. How can I survive the kind of stuff you're surviving, Paul? How in the world can you be content with everything that you've had to face? And then in the next verse, he tells us. And the next verse is one of the most famous in the entire New Testament. It's also, I think, one of the most misapplied in all the New Testament. It's one of those verses that you've probably heard in some way, shape, or form. You've seen it written somewhere. And unfortunately, it's so pithy, it's so easy to remember that people have yanked it out of context and applied it to all different kinds of stuff. But the context for this verse is, this is the Apostle Paul's summary for how you live with contentment in the midst of circumstances that are chaotic, in his case, actually life-threatening. Are you ready? Here it is. Tell us how, Paul. I can do all of this. All what, Paul? Persecuted, run out of town, stoned, left for dead. But I can do all of this through him. Maybe you grew up in a church with the King James Bible and it said through Christ. I can do all of this. I can survive all of this and maintain my contentment through Christ who gives me strength. And literally, if I could just add one word to that, Paul, we can talk about when I get to heaven, okay? Because I just want to add one word to that for clarification. Who gives me his strength. Because there is a mystery. Maybe this is why he chose that word. But there is a mystery for believers. There's a mystery for Christians. We're actually, the life of Jesus, the strength of Jesus, the endurance of Jesus is available to you and available to me through Christ. So Paul says, I can do all of this through him, through Christ, who gives me his strength. Now, just to be clear, and maybe be a little bit critical, I want to tell you what he's not talking about, okay? He's not talking about this. Now, this is a wonderful, well-meaning Christian high school, I'm sure, and their football team is about to run through this banner to go out and win the big name through Christ who gives us strength. And Paul is up in heaven saying, really? I mean, like, I'm rotting away in prison and you use this to motivate your football team and go out there and beat another team into submission. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about winning something. I'm talking about surviving something. I'm not talking about a trophy. I'm talking about rewards in heaven. This isn't Rocky. I'm in jail. I'm fighting for my life. And I debated whether to use that because this is cute and God bless them. I think it's awesome. But I just want you to know, you ripped this verse out of context. And this is a big deal to me, but you rip this verse out of context, I think you miss the secret of contentment. That I can be fine on the inside even though the world around me is out of control. I can do all things through Him who strengthens me. I can do all things through Him who strengthens me with His strength. So let me just summarize this for you and break it down as simply as I know how. And then I'm going to give you a homework assignment. I know this is what you wanted to hear on Labor Day weekend. I'm going to give you a homework assignment. I know you love that. But here's essentially what Paul is saying. He's saying, I can't. He can. He can through me. I can't. He can. He can through me. I can't. I mean, I'm not able. I mean, I'm cool, and I'm strong, and I'm educated. I've got it all going on. I've got a 401k. I have a nice car. I've got friends. But when it comes to this bad boy that I'm facing, I can't. It's beyond me. I'm not going to pretend I can. I'm not going to lie and say I can. I'm just going to admit right up front, I can't handle this. But Jesus can. And the reason I know Jesus can is because He dragged His own cross up that hill and died for my sin. And if you can do that on purpose, if you can do that intentionally, then what I'm facing is nothing compared to that. And that's why the Apostle Paul said, I can't. He can. And most importantly, He can through me. If you're single, and you're sick and tired of being single, and you tried being unsingle, and that just made your life more complicated. And now you're in another season of being single, and there are options, but you know those options are just going to complicate your life. You can't. He can. He can through you. You're pregnant. And that pregnancy means the end of your dreams. The end of your world. The end of your life as you knew it. This was not what you wanted. This is not what you had in your future. But you were pregnant. You were thinking, I could not have this baby. You can't. He can. And He can through you. You're just miserable without Him. When He was in your life, things were bad. But now He's gone and you're miserable without Him. And you want Him back so badly. But you know that's just going to throw you way outside the will of God and way outside what God wants for you. But you just want Him back and you don't know what to do. You can't. But that's okay. Just say, God, I can't. But you can. You can through me. Things aren't good at home. I mean, every day you're driving home, you don't know what you're driving home to. Or you're there and you hear the garage door open and you don't know who's going to be walking in because there are about three different versions of him or three different versions of her and you're just kind of waiting to see which version comes home today. And you say, God, I can't keep doing this. And your Heavenly Father says, you can't. But it's all right. Because I can. And I can through you. You know what that is? It's the mystery of Christ in you. Your health isn't good. The doctors kind of shrug and say, we can monitor it. We can treat it, we just can't cure it. And you say, I can't. And you're right, you can't. But He can. And He can through you. It's a mystery. Because our Savior lives in you. So let me give you a homework assignment. When you came in this morning, you were given a card. Okay? Here's your homework assignment. I want you to do this for at least a week. And some of you need to do it throughout this season of life because things are so tough. But in the morning, I want you, before you get out of bed, I want you to say the following. It's the top part of the card. I want you to say this before you even get out of bed. I can't, but you can. Before your feet hit the floor, I can't, you can. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. Before I even start, I'm just going to acknowledge, good morning, God. I can't, but you can. Then when you go to bed at night, and this is the mysterious part, I know. You know, evening, though, is kind of mysterious. There are different things at night going on when you go to bed. It's just a different kind of time. But when you go to bed at night, I just want you to whisper this prayer. Teach me the mystery of Christ in me. Teach me the mystery of Christ in me. God, would you please teach me the mystery as a Christian of Christ in me, through me. I want to, and this is important, I want to learn the secret of contentment. So every morning, Lord, I just want to declare, I can't, but I believe you can. And every night, God, I want you to teach me the mystery of you living your life through me. I want to pray for you, and I want to pray something very specific. But the bottom line of this message is simply this. I want all of us to think about that thing in our life that just stirs our discontentment more than anything else. It's that thing that just won't change. It's that thing about you that you just can't change. But that thing, whatever it is, that thing is the epicenter of where God has the greatest potential to do the greatest work in your life. It is. It was Paul being in prison that launched his writing ministry that changed the whole world. So here's what I want to say. You have no idea what God wants to do in you and through you in the midst of these circumstances. And right in the center of that is this thing that just stirs and churns your discontentment. I want you to think about that as I pray for you. And I want you to take that card home with you today and look at that and pray that. For at least the next week. Okay. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, most of us have lived long enough to know that it's in that tension that you really do have the greatest opportunity. Because in that tension, that's where you get our attention. So Father, I pray that you'll just give us eyes to see things the way that you see them. And teach us the secret of contentment right there with him or with her, with them, with it, whatever it is. And God, I confess on all of our behalf that we can't. But you can. And you can through us. We can't. But you can. And you can through us. God, teach us the secret of contentment. And use that thing that we would never choose again to demonstrate your glory through us in ways that we could never, ever imagine. Father, we pray all these things through the matchless name of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who lives in and through us.
Through that, because I know myself, I can't do it on my own. I never thought I'd be in seminary, and I'm about to graduate in May, and there's no way I'm doing it on my own. So thank you, Pastor Bruce. There's one saying I heard that reminded me. I think it was from a pastor I heard on Christian radio, and it's like the enemy, you know, the spiritual world, the enemy is watching you, and then when you're going through those difficult times, and you get up, and you put your feet on the floor, and you rise up, the enemy goes, oh no. She's up again. She's up again. And that's Christ working through you. So thank you, Pastor Bruce. Would you join me in prayer as we get ready for our offering?
Heavenly Father, there is mystery in Christ, your Son, and we don't understand it all. But Lord, would you work in our hearts to help us to endure, to help us to depend on you, and though that we may not see how you're working, but that through our faith, we can trust in you, that we know you'll do a good work in us and through us. We thank you for how you're working through Imagine Church, and we thank you for all that have come today. We ask that you would bless the giver and be with those when we walk out those doors. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Vocalist or a singer, it doesn't matter. The words will lift you up. So when you're singing these words and you're saying them and you're trying to sing with the melody, let them wash over your body. Let them really do something to you and with you and for you. This next song, our closing song this morning, is so good. Don't let it pass you by. We are not skilled to understand what God has willed for us. And you're just to walk in faith and know that He's got this. We can, but He can. God has planned. I only know in His right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take Him at His word and believe. Christ died to save me, this I read.
After me. Lord Jesus, we love you.
Lord Jesus, we love you.
And we go now to serve you.
We go now to serve you.
Amen.